I love this time of year because there's such a sense of wonder that God became human. And even, you know, people that don't even like God have a hard time being grumpy all through the season. Although sometimes people who love God get all stressed out because we get our focus on, you know, the big to-do list and how many people we know that we don't know what to buy for and all those things. So we just speak peace, 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 and that our focus would be on the wonder of the season. And I'm reminded of this, that in 1971 was a very good year for me. I was 20. I did turn 21 in the autumn of 71. It's easy math. And so now you know how old I am in case you're interested. But the anyway, it was the time of seeking in my life and Anne's life, and Anne had just reappeared into my life. I knew her, you know, we knew when you're teenagers, and then we're kind of, God was keeping us apart until the fullness of time. But so that was a great year, and we did a lot of things, and we're really hungry spiritually, even though we didn't know the Lord. And we just were full of life. It's amazing if you get a bunch of 20-year-olds that are in love, they're just creative and they have energy. And when Halloween came, we talked all our friends into, we all got union suits. Now, some of you are too young to know, it's a one-piece long underwear with a little flap in the back, but the which was buttoned or sewed shut, I'm not sure. Anyway, we got these union suits and we dyed them different colors, and we went all over our town at night on that night of October 31st singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And it snowed while we were singing. It was so magical. And when you're 20, you don't get cold. Especially if you're in love, you're just all excited about everything. But then we were actually seeking. I mean, that's just a little vignette picture. But on Christmas Eve, we had this big plan. Now, Anne's family had this amazing tradition. They'd have a wonderful Christmas Eve dinner and one of my favorites was, they always made hot sauerkraut and put gravy on it. Her father was Polish. That's, you know, kind of came from that side of the family. But it was this great meal. And then afterwards, her mom would have us pick names in the middle of summer. Like we got these names, we all picked names for Christmas. And so even though we were poor and young, didn't have much money, we had months to think about a thoughtful gift for this person. Like the wise men coming from the east, they had a lot of time to think about what to give the Christ child. Well, we had a lot of time to think about what to give each other. And the evening would come, and unlike my family where it was mass chaos and all the paper just, it was, you know, the gifts were broken before noon on Christmas. That was my upbringing. But her family is like this amazing tradition, one gift at a time. One of the young grandchildren would read the name and give it to the person, and they would read who it was from, and they would carefully unwrap it, and especially the ones who wanted to reuse the paper for the next year. And then they would be, honestly, most of the gifts were really great. A lot of them were handmade and just beautiful. So in this time, you know, we're in love, you know, we're falling in love, well, we hadn't planned to get married yet, but we're on our way. I guess we had, the idea had crossed our mind, but we were a spiritual seeker, so we thought we want to do something really spiritual. What could be more spiritual than going to midnight mass? And I had never been to a mass in my whole life, but, you know, I was in after anything spiritual, so we were planning it, and it was so strange. Around 10:30, Anne just didn't feel well. And, I mean, she got really feeling pretty bad. It was a shellfish allergy that we didn't realize what was at work. And it was, I mean, God used this because I was disappointed, you know, because I was looking forward to this. And, of course, she said, well, you can go. And I thought, I've never been to a mass in my life. I don't know what to do. I don't know how, you know, if there's some special protocol. And so we waited, and it was an amazing thing because in the spring, you know, we're going up on the spring, the vernal equinox. We climb up to the top of the mountain, up on top of a fire lookout tower and freeze to death, hoping to, you know, have some kind of supernatural encounter. And God sent some Christians into our lives who helped us out, and we were surprised. And so then that kind of, we thought we should go to church. I wanted to put $2 in the offering so I could pay back the universe. Because, you know, I didn't know what would happen to me next time around, because that was my belief matrix. But the most amazing thing happened, because these Christians helped us and we went to this church, we found ourselves in the midst of a group that worshiped God and believed in miracles. And there were a lot of young people. They were very informal meetings. But when they would worship, we would encounter the presence of God. And this is what drew us. So we kept going back to the meetings. And within about 3 weeks, I was down on my knees and asked Jesus to make himself real to me and said I would follow him all my life. And he did. And so this, we met the Lord. It was really awesome. And so then, you know, there's a whole new cycle, another Christmas season coming, and we have our gifts, and we're all prepared. This time's different because we've witnessed everybody in the whole family. And a few of them accepted the Lord, you know, and it was great. And so, and that night, we made it to the midnight mass. And Ann had been to masses before, but I hadn't. And so we come in, I don't know what to do. And, you know, it's unusual to me, because now I've had since May or April the year before in these encounters with the presence of God. And this is stand up, sit down, and they're reading all the scriptures really fast. And I'm mixed up. I don't know if I'm supposed to read the blue or the red. But any scripture that's being read, I'm trying to read it real slow with meaning, because it's like, this is my worship. And there's this drunk behind me named George. I found out his name because his wife kept saying, "Stop it, George, stop it, George." But he began to mock us because we were like so sincere. And he's totally mocking us. And I had long hair and all this stuff, and he didn't, and you know, so, but his worst parts are being exposed. And then I'm sitting there, and it's like the priest gives the homily, and Father Lacey, my hometown didn't have the best priest in the whole diocese. I can tell you that. It was a little mountain town, and he was old and crotchety and had a drinking problem, and I'm sure he was lonely. A lot of old priests, especially in a small parish. He was on the National Ski Patrol, so sometimes we'd see him up on the mountain. And so Father Lacey gives this totally uninspiring 10-minute talk about how Jesus must have been a really great guy. And I'm like, what? You know, and so then it's time for communion, and I don't go up because I don't know the protocol. And then we leave, and everybody's dipping their fingers in the holy water, and I think, well, I think I can do that, you know. But we leave there, and I am so thankful at the sovereignty of God that he knew the timing, and he knew that at Little All Saints Parish in Twain Heart, California, wouldn't be the place where I would find what I needed. Now, since that time, I've been to a few charismatic masses where I'm just weeping and encountering the presence of God. And thank God, I pray, Father Lacey, rest in peace. But the next priest who came after him was a young priest, and he was in love with Jesus. And you couldn't even listen to him without encountering the love of God. And so, so I just know this is a time when people are seeking and people are after encounters with God. And sometimes all of the pressures of, you know, what toys to get or how many Christmas cards to write can all be a distraction from what this is really all about, why the whole world acknowledges this thing. Even people who don't believe in God, they're kind of irritated by it, but most of the world is acknowledging that something miraculous happened that changed the history of the world, changed the calendar system, changed all kinds of things. And my prayer for you is that we would have an encounter, and that each one of us would have an encounter, and that actually on Christmas, rather than being depressed, you would have worship. You know how it works? There's all this anticipation, like, and then the day comes and it's kind of like, that's it? Ever felt that way? 2 o'clock on Christmas afternoon, or, you know, whenever, 3 o'clock, now there's all this mess in the kitchen to clean up, and all the kids are out, and half the toys are broken. In my house, the toys were broken by noon, but I had 4 brothers, and we competed with each other for bad behavior, but the, and so occasionally I was the winner, but the, anyway, the, so that's kind of the background, but God, I just want to pray. Would you like to have a Christmas where you feel the presence of God and you experience this? And this is, I mean, I'm so thankful that in the fullness of time, God knew where we needed to encounter Christianity and for at least our introduction. So Holy Spirit, I pray that you would come upon us, not only this morning as we listen, as we continue to worship, but as we go through this season, that you would come in a special way and you would hover over our homes with power, and that this would be a season of miracles, even as we've had some healings this morning, that they would continue, that there would be salvations, that there would be deliverances, and there would be mercy and goodness extended to all. We thank you for Edgar and his work in Guatemala. Today and tomorrow, God, we just pray there would be an outpouring of your Spirit and your love in each one of these poor communities in the dump, that hearts would be glad. We pray for Harrisburg. We pray for the poor here and in Lancaster and York and in this area, and for all the people joining us online, that you would pour out your Spirit in and around us, in our homes, in our communities. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I have a title called A God Who Takes Our Frame, you know, and I was thinking, well, that's a little obscure, you know, but I did think we should call it The Holy Ghost and Christmas, but anyway, it is what it is. And God, I mean, the thing that I see in Christmas is we have faith in a God who makes his promises in dark times. You know, like when we're at our worst, he gives us the best promise. Have you ever had that happen? Like you were really trying hard to be your worst, and God speaks to you about something hopeful and good. And if you've never had that happen, I pray that he invades your own personal funk and releases a sense of divine hope. And last week I talked about the power of a new song. Isaiah 42, sing to the Lord a new song. And just a tiny bit of review here. I love this. The new song is a refusal to accept the present world as it is. And often prophetic promises, though we read them as prose, came in song. I mean, do you understand there is the possibility that God actually sang the entire universe into existence? We read it like, and the Lord said, but we don't know what it sounded like, you know. And he was a God of music. The new song is a protest, boldly and innocently proclaiming that the God of the gospel has plans and purposes and a will to reorder the world. And it proclaims God's future against our present disappointments. And when we sing the song of the Lord, we taste and live the new creation. And some of you, if you have this ability that we not only pray with our mind, but we pray in the Spirit. We not only sing with our mind, but we sing with the Spirit. That when we enter into these new songs of the Lord, we're declaring the future that is to come. And I, you know, which is not necessarily declared by the news or by, you know, commentators and all that kind of stuff. But the best commentator on the future is always the Holy Spirit. And when God speaks to us, that's what the reality is. Here's the thing. We think of the Father, we think of the Son. The Father created all things. We believe in one God, the Lord Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things invisible, invisible, and invisible. And one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the only begotten of the Father, by whom all things were made. And so the Father and the Son, we know, were involved in creation. I mean, the Father created all things, but he had the Son do it. You know, like, just what a joy. And so we read in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth and all that's in them. But we sometimes don't ponder verse 2. It says, everything was a big mess. You know, it was without form and void. And there was the Holy Spirit hovering over the face of the deep and getting it ready for the next creative statement, let there be light. And so this is from the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and by him all things were made. Without him was not anything made that is made. And so we often see that, but sometimes we don't know that the Holy Spirit coming upon our lives in power will always bring forth something new. And thank you. God makes his promises in the dark, and the Holy Spirit comes and changes everything. So just a little review, you know, in the fullness of time, Galatians 4:4, God sent forth his son in the fullness of time, born of a virgin, born under the law, to redeem us from the law of sin and death. So at Luke 1:30, the angel comes to Mary and he says, don't be afraid. And you found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, which means salvation. It means Yahweh saves. The I am that I am saves. Now, we don't know how shocking this is. This is a young woman from a village that had a bad reputation. In an occupied country, in the worst part of the country, where people had hillbilly accents, and the angel Gabriel comes to her and tells her, don't be afraid, you're going to have a baby. And she's like, what? You know, and not only is she going to have a baby, she's going to have a son. Was quite sure about the gender there. And even though he gives him the name, you shall call his name Yeshua. God saves, a common name, a reasonably common name at that time. And so her question is the same question any of us has. Sometimes when God comes to us in times when we don't expect it, we're saying, God, that's impossible. How can the impossible happen? She didn't say it's impossible, you don't know what you're talking about. She asked, how can the impossible happen? And here's the answer. And this is the answer for us. Verse 35, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And therefore, the child to be born of you will be called holy, the Son of God. In verse 37, he wraps it up and he says, Mary, nothing is impossible with God. There's not a single word or promise God speaks that does not contain the creative power to bring it to pass. And so her response is a response that each one of us has when God comes to us and whispers a promise to us or makes it a huge encounter. She said, behold the handmaiden of the Lord. Behold, I am the Lord's servant. Be it unto me. Let it be to me according to the word you've spoken. And the angel left. And so we think that's the end of the story because the next verse goes right into a new subject. But I think when Mary speaks, let it be, that the wind begins to blow. You know, whether it was a physical wind or just a spirit wind, that the Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, begins to move upon her and she enters into an encounter. And sometimes God can do very profound things and it's kind of almost like we didn't notice it, but everything changes. But sometimes we get caught in encounters where it may go on for quite a period of time. And it can be profound beyond words. And sometimes, you know, I mean, there are probably, I know there's a number of people here in this room that you've had times where God encountered you and you couldn't move or you couldn't speak and you were stuck in that encounter until the encounter lifted, because God can do whatever he wants, you know, like, a young woman was sharing with me last week, a fairly new believer seeking praying, reading the word, hadn't received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and God came upon her for a period of several hours, maybe 3 hours, shaking, crying, having joy, laughter, being outside of her body, observing all of this going on. It went on for hours. At the end, she said she just kind of, everything simmered down. She experienced and had an understanding of the wrath of God against sin and against its damages to his beloved. And really profound, answered a lot of questions. And when it was all over, she kind of just tipped over and slept in peace. Everything changes. What do you think, I mean, if that happens to some of us, what happened to Mary? I mean, what happened to Mary when the Holy Spirit came upon her and the power of the Most High God overshadowed her under the shadow of his wings? For how long, you know, for what intensity did, you know, what happened in that period of time? You know, there's not a lot of detail. If you think about it, a lot of these stories are mom telling the story later on to either her adult son, Jesus, or to the disciples, John and the others who gathered around here. Tell us the stories. How did this happen? It's so, you know, it's probably you don't share it with little children, but I imagine as Jesus got older, they said, well, you really want to hear this stuff, and these are family stories that are now shared with us. And so she has this encounter with God and she comes out of it supernaturally pregnant. You know, at least, you know, half of 23 genes were supernaturally delivered to her. I mean, you know, if you think about it, like the human genome, humans are made of 20, I mean, our instructions are found in 23 pairs of genes. You know, dogs have 39 pairs of genes, you know, so fruit flies have 4, you know, but humans, we have 23, Psalm 23. I don't know why we have 23. Two of them determine our sex, and the others just determine, you know, a lot of general information and some distinct, you know, peculiar things about that. So she has this encounter, and when she comes out of it, I don't think she had to wonder, like, did that really happen? I suspect when the Holy Ghost came upon her and the power of the Most High overshadowed her, she knew what happened to Mary. It was unto her according to her word. And so this is the same Holy Spirit who, I mean, he hovered over the chaos at creation and prepared it for the rest. He came and he blew on the Red Sea when Israel was fleeing Egypt and they came to the immovable barrier. The wind, a strong wind came and blew all night. Maybe the Holy Spirit, this holy wind of God, was at least part of that. You know, and then he would come on the day of Pentecost, first into an upper room and then throughout the whole city of Jerusalem and move on thousands of people, ushering in a new creation, the church, that would be completely different, would be a holy nation, a royal priesthood who would carry the very essence and values of God, who would walk in a supernatural humility and courage and power and, you know, and it still to this day moves on God's people to give us a boldness and a fearlessness toward death so that we can give our lives as martyrs, we can give our reputation as witnesses and as evangelists for the good news. And God, just come upon us. Would you like God to come upon you in the darkness of your own futility? You know, those places where you go like, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's like, well, he does. Thank you, Jesus. And so, you know, I mean, the crazy thing is the Holy Spirit often comes when we're exhausted, and he comes when the world is exhausted, when we look and everything we read is bad and there's some big conspiracy that's going to ruin everything even worse than it's already ruined. And it's like when the world is exhausted, when our imaginations fail and our lives shut down in silence and despair, that's a good time for the Holy Spirit to come. They that sat in darkness saw a great light.
which means they were sitting in darkness. Okay. And isn't it amazing that often God, what God tells us contradicts everything that our common sense would tell us? Have you ever thought, like, I don't know if I should say this or not because people are going to think I'm crazy if this doesn't happen. And thank God that you spoke up, because there's something about that speaking up that's like, let it be to me according to your word. If the world seems unsavable, God sends a baby whose name is salvation. Ah, and I love it. We sing this song. We're going to sing it later. Who is God that he should take our frame? Who is God that he should take our frame? That in his humility, he would leave everything and come and be found as a human, not a full-grown human being with powers and authority, but as a helpless baby. Thank you. That he would take our frame, the artisan inside the paint, or breathe the very breath. Breathe the very air. His breath sustains the architect inside the plan. Thank you, Jesus. So he comes to Mary. And of course, just having Mary is not going to fulfill the whole picture. But Jesus needs a father. He needs a human father. Foster father, adopted father. I think he's definitely adopted. He named the son. And so God comes to Joseph in a different way. Joseph has a problem, you know. Matthew gives us a story. A lot of it's the same as what Luke writes concerning Mary. Matthew writes, Matthew 1:18, now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, oh, that's nice, that's special. Before they came together, she was found to be with child. That's not special. That's a problem. From the Holy Spirit. Like, come on. Are you serious? So anyway, that must be what she told Joseph. And this caused Joseph quite a bit of turmoil. Verse 19, her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, or I like the New Revised Version says, but just when he had resolved to do this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. And isn't it funny how we come up with solutions and they're inadequate, even though they're as good as we can come up with? Now, Joseph's solution was at considerable cost. He was a righteous man. He was a tzaddik in his community. Holy, happy, healthy, the kind of person people wanted to be around, you know, future rabbi of the synagogue. I mean, you know, this is Joseph the carpenter, but he's a holy man. He's a good man. Well, of course, Mary and Joseph, you know, out of the entire universe, God says, hey, I could use these two as my parents. If I have to be a baby, I want Maria and Giuseppe. You know, they're going to take good care of me. And so he's unwilling to put her to shame. What does that mean? It means normally the way a girl gets pregnant when she's engaged and the fiancé is not the father is there's somebody else involved. And so in that culture, it meant that she could possibly be stoned to death, and at the minimum, she would be scorned and shamed and always be a woman, of ill repute. And he's torn because he knows this is impossible. I can't believe, his heart's broken, his mind is offended, everything inside him that makes no sense at all, and yet he has this encounter with her presence telling him the story that he can't believe, and he's like, this is destroying my brain. Has that ever happened to you? Like, it's just like, God, just can't be. And so he's saying, what can I do? What can I do? And so he finally resolved, okay, I'm going to sacrifice my own reputation, and I'm going to write her a bill of divorce, which Moses gives to hard-hearted husbands who say, I don't love my wife anymore. So now If he had just married her, everyone would have thought, well, Joseph, we thought he was a holy man, but obviously he's lacking self-control because she's already pregnant on the wedding day. So that would have been a fairly bad reputation, but divorcing her is the ultimate sacrifice of his reputation. Why wouldn't he do that? Because he couldn't believe her story. Like, who could? I mean, no, it's impossible. And so he resolves, okay, I'm going to totally I can't marry her because I always wonder who the father is, and I'm going to sacrifice my own reputation, which everybody in the village who thought he was such a good guy is now going to say, this guy is the worst rotten scoundrel in our entire village. First, he gets the girl pregnant because he has no self-control, and then he decides he doesn't like her. And so he's divorcing her so she can live the writ of divorce actually gave her permission to remarry, but it's like, what kind of a man would do this? He's not just rejecting this beautiful sweetheart of the village, but he's rejecting his own child. And that's what he decided to do. I mean, it wasn't such a bad plan. I mean, it was probably as kind a plan as he could come up with. And in the middle of that, as soon as he's like there on bed, like, oh, that's it. Okay, that's what I'm going to do. And he falls asleep, and he falls into a dream. And in the dream comes the angel. Going to mess with Joseph's plan. Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary for your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Ah! Wonder if he woke up. Because, I mean, I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit can contradict our sense of what's real and what's normal and what's right. And whatever he says is right. And then he keeps going. It's from the Holy Spirit, verse 21. She will bear a son, and you, Joseph, you shall call his name Jesus, salvation. For he will save his people from their sins, even you, Joseph. Maybe I might have added that or not. But do you understand, like Joseph, and this is like, oh, and he wakes up. Of course he woke up. Like, what kind of dream is that? And the thing is, now I'm just making it comical because that way you won't get bored, but this is something he actually went through. This is like in the song, okay? The one who had no start and knows no end became confined to time and tense. The everlasting God, the great I am, in the mercy of a mother's hand. What's amazing is he comes into the world to save the world. He comes into the world not to become the king, not to become, you know, famous, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Oh, man. And so then Matthew's comment, verse 22, is all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Prophet Isaiah again. Isaiah 7:14, maybe he's saying this too. Verse 23, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means, for those who don't speak Hebrew, God with us. When Joseph woke from the sleep, he did what, as the angel of the Lord commanded him, he took his wife, and he knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus, salvation. Yahweh saves. The great I am has sent salvation. Now, this is such a wild and crazy story, and I'm telling you, God is bigger than our brains. And if he wasn't, he couldn't deal with the impossible situations that seem impossible to us with this statement, nothing is impossible to God. So I want to wrap up with just a reference back to Isaiah 43, another one of Isaiah's beautiful songs. Remember not the former things. And this is what, when we have an encounter with the Holy Spirit, this is a very important word. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I do a new thing. I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not know it? Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I mean, this is so amazing. So the word of God comes to us when we're totally exhausted. And And it's like, and he tells us, hey, forget all that stuff. I'm doing something new. And it's a word from God that we need to hear and obey. And the amazing thing is, Joseph did, he actually did what he was told. And why would we not want to remember the former things? It's, number one, it's a total waste of energy. Some of us remember all the good things. You know, we remember, oh man, I wish it was like it was. And I, you know, we remember stuff with nostalgia. We value things that were true, but I'm telling you, it will never go back to what it was. It will only go forward to what it will be. So we can waste our time just fondly remembering the good old days and kind of, we could live, you know, like get a 1956 Chevy Bel Air. And if you have one, this is not anything offended. And we could play music from the 50s, and we could kind of get a haircut from the 50s and wear clothes from the 50s or 60s and or 70s. That would be bad clothes and bad hair and bad cars, actually. But the but it's like we can't go back to those days. And likewise, so those are the temptation for some of us. Some of us have terrible, painful memories that we can't let go of. Shame and pain and regrets and guilt and hurt and anger and the way people have mistreated us. And the only solution to getting free is to forget them. Don't think about them. Remember them. Don't remember that. We give it to God. The only way we get healed is we give it to God. Not only repenting of our pain, but also repenting of our idols, you know, the things that keep us from moving forward. And God speaks clearly to us in his Son, and he says, behold, I'm doing a new thing. When he entered the earth, a whole new world began. It's the beginning of the new heavens and the new earth. And he says, the past is displaced by the new creation. If anyone is in Christ, they're not what they were. They're a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. That's the reality we live in. Come on. And this is why we celebrate Christmas, because, you know, right there, there's one way. He says, I'm going to make a way in the wilderness. And that way, Jesus said, I am the way. I'm the truth, the life, and you can't get to the Father but by me. But I love it that he says, and there'll be rivers in the wilderness. So there's one way, there's many rivers, and they come to us when we need them. And I just pray that you would find refreshing on the journey over and over again. And so God calls us that no matter what empire we're worried about, no matter what, I mean, you know, Caesar, you know, Augustus Caesar renamed himself Augustus Caesar, big ego, big, you know, big empire, lots of taxes and big armies. And then there was Herod, who was ambitious and treacherous and paranoid and crazy and killed his own kids and his wives along with the babies in Bethlehem. And in none of that phases what God was releasing in the earth, there's good news. So I want to pray for you that, why don't you stand up, pray for you that the Holy Spirit would fill you with anticipation and expectation, that he would open your heart and your spirit, my heart and my spirit, to the new thing God is doing. And that you know, we're going to sing his arrival here in a minute. We're going to sing, I love this song. And I just thought, I want to sing this as the last song we sing here on a Sunday morning before Christmas, because we celebrate his arrival. But I want to tell you something, he is coming again. You know, he's coming again. It's not over, and it's not like we're just gonna slug it out and slug it out and slug it out until everything's perfect. We are going to occupy till he comes, but he said, I will come. The angel said to these disciples, you know, why are you staring into heaven? The same Jesus who you see leaving will come again in like manner. And I don't know what that means. Neither did anyone know what it meant when Isaiah said a virgin would have a son and call his name Emmanuel. But I'm telling you, he's on our side. We thank you that you came. We thank you that you humbled yourself, became human, became a servant, died on the cross, and that the Father has highly exalted you and given you the name above every name, that at your name every knee would bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Thank you. Oh, we love you. We pray, Holy Spirit, you would come and visit each home, each heart here. That this would be a Christmas season to remember. We worship you. Amen. Well, I know there are some here, you came here seeking, not knowing God, but seeking God, knowing about him, but not knowing him in a transforming encounter called being born again. And maybe you've tried that and it didn't work. And we just invite you to return. I mean, it probably did work, but we make mistakes and our hearts get hardened. And he calls you to return. And I just say, if today's the day you came seeking him, he was seeking you, and that's why you're here. And he came to seek and save ones who've lost their way, ones who are lost in sin, ones who've lost in discouragement and confusion. Just invite you, you want to come forward. This is a great place to make peace with God and have those encounters that will mark your life and fill you with eternal life. So that's the invitation. That would be the best Christmas gift that you could receive, and the best Christmas, that would make your life a gift as well. Just invite you. Don't run out. It's not that important. You can come forward as we leave. There'll be people up here ready to introduce you to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for all you've done. Thank you. And if you don't want to wait, you can come forward now. It's the invitation is there. And we love you, Lord Jesus. We love you. We pray your blessing and your presence would be on every home and every heart here. That the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the continual communion with the Holy Spirit would be with you all. And may you be blessed as you go. Carry the light in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Merry Christmas. Jesus.